wasn't so defield that it would be outright turned around. So they just made sure that what they were working on was within their mandate, was within what would be acceptable to consider, so that they were being efficient with their time and with their conversations. The Healthy Rivers Wairoa Committee then provided a recommendation to Council, Waikato Regional Council, and Waikato Regional Council had that public accountability under the Resource Management Act, and they were the final decision makers. But in accordance with the treaty settlement legislation, if we couldn't get the Five River area reform and content of the plan change, it couldn't go up to council. So in terms of that process, what we did, and I think we did reasonably successfully, is we ensured that River Iwi were involved in each step of the way and at each milestone, so that when we got to the final milestone, we weren't going to be surprised with the decisions that were coming through. This is the first time that co-management in this catchment has ever been undertaken. The first plan change, so it's been a learning experience for everybody. How they operate is outlined in the legislation, but they were provided with the equivalent of $220 million, and that was for the restoration and protection of the Waikato and Waikato catchments and all the water bodies and those catchments. So that's run as a separate organisation. There are Crown appointees on that organisation. And they have been developing a restoration strategy with a large number of stakeholders and a lot of stuff like that. The district council has been involved in those discussions to identify what the priorities are in terms of how that money is spent and how do you leverage the money that you've got to do more. And so one of their approaches has been that we'll put in money, but we expect others to also put in money as well. So, they're becoming, they're a new organisation, but they are getting in, and they are, through this work restoration strategy, it will become clearer to the broader community on what those priorities are, and if people are willing for funding, what are the parameters of that will be most successful.
Thank you, Joe. So my name is Emma. I'm a policy advisor for the Waikato Regional Council. One of my roles is to work and help the collaborative stakeholder group for the last more than 2 years. So really we wrote the reports, provided the information, and helped write down what they want to do in the change. That was my role. What I'm going to do today is give you an overview of what's in the plan change. I've got a few resources in front of you that I'll take you through as well. Hopefully you'll find that some of the questions you have So I just wanted to start with an overview and then really focus on the questions that you guys have. So the plan change is quite a large document, but within it there's these 70 policy areas. And if anyone opens the Section 32 evaluation report, they'll see that the topics that the plan change has been broken down into are these 7 areas. So I'd just like to touch on each of them so we get an overall feel of what's in the document. So the first one is really the staged approach. So one of the first key decisions that the collaborative stakeholder group made was really does 10% along with